Welcome back to the lecture about biomass analysis. This is the introduction to Fitchy. Fitchy is a quite popular software in the field. Fitchy is just ImageJ with batteries included. So let's first have a look what ImageJ is. So Core ImageJ is a software, something like, oh, is it 20 years old? Something like that. It usually has this main window with some buttons and a lot of menus. Then you have windows where you can see your images. In this case, we are looking at an image stack of a Drosophila embryo. And you have kind of gray value images, you have binary images, and you have images with annotations. You also have some additional windows where you can, for example, deal with annotations, and windows where you can deal with measurements, like a results table in this particular case. So this is kind of core ImageJ. This is the functionality ImageJ provides. And on top of this, there are like hundreds of plugins for any kind of image analysis. For example, if you want to know in this particular image to see that there are lines in different directions, in which directions are they actually, you can use this so-called directionality plugin to measure the direction of objects in an image. And you can actually draw a histogram of directions of objects in an image. So this is what the directionality plugin allows you. Has some ridge detection plugins, for example, if you have some lines, bacteria moving around or stuff like that, if you want to analyze them, you can use the ridge detection plugin. There's tools like TrackMate, which allows you to investigate videos in two dimensions, in three dimensions over time, and get lineage trees out of dividing cells in videos over time. And there are tools like the Big Data Viewer. Big Data Viewer allows you to look into three-dimensional, four-dimensional images of terabyte size, which are much too big for your laptop, for your little computer. But you can still look into this data with the Big Data Viewer. There are tools like Multiview Fusion, when you have kind of you acquired your sample from different perspectives with a microscope, which was doing that for you. And you want to bring all these different images from different perspectives. You want to bring them back in one image, want to have a look at them all together. You use Multiview Fusion. Or also a similar tool if you have acquired many images, many stacks using electron microscopy, and you want to bring them all together and annotate objects over several images, then you use, for example, the TrackEM plugin. So you see, Fitchy contains quite some sophisticated plugins which can solve many different kind of scientific questions. So that's like large plugins which have full functionality, but you have on the other hand, you have also low-level image processing tools. For example, let's start at, we have some image like that that shows a Drosophila embryo, actually just a two-dimensional plane through a Drosophila embryo. And we can, for example, subtract the background in this image. And we can apply a Gaussian blur. So these are operations we will learn in the next lecture, by the way. And then divide the one image by the other to see the objects a bit better than we saw them in the original image. We can then do maxima detection to find where the objects are actually sitting. We can apply a so-called seeded watershed, and we can do some image, some particle analysis and filtering, and then visualize the regions of interest we found in that image on the original data set. So that's very small steps. You will again learn many of them in the following lectures. So that's very small processing steps which lead us from a raw data set to an annotated data set where we can actually get some proper measurements out. So in all these plugins, the small plugins and the big plugins are all appearing in menus in Fitchy. So that tells us that ImageJ is very flexible. We can do many things with that. It's applicable to many different kinds of images, many different scientific questions we can ask, but it's also kind of unfortunate for user experience. So if everything is kind of hidden in menus, it's even for the experts super hard to keep an eye on what is all there and to know about all the tools which are in there. And furthermore, also the maintenance of all these tools is quite complicated. So somebody has to take care of all of them, right? So this is kind of the drawbacks of having a platform with so many functionality in there. Furthermore, Fitchy is extensible, or ImageJ is extensible. So you find actually a website where there is a list of additional so-called update sites, which brings even more menu entries to your ImageJ, to your Fitchy, and makes it even more complicated to look through and to find things you want to use for your particular image analysis. And therefore, at some point, we integrated a little search field here in the Fiji main window, so you can kind of type what you are looking for. So for example, if you want to do a background subtraction, or if you want to apply a threshold to a data set, then you enter threshold in this search field and you see what's coming up. And then you will likely find among the first entries in this list, you will find this operation you wanted to apply. I'm just saying that people who are using ImageStay in Fiji a lot do not go through these menus anymore. They mostly use this search field, so you should definitely give it a try. Furthermore, a typical Fiji example workflow looks like this. So we start from an image, and we apply a threshold to it to differentiate between objects and background. So in this case, the objects are marked in red, right? Then we set measurements. We tell the software what we want to measure. For example, we want to measure the area of these objects, or the center of mass, or the standard deviation and the mean gray value in these objects. So this is typical things we want to get out of images. Then we run the so-called particle analyzer. The particle analyzer takes this list of things we want to measure and takes the image and the segmentation, so the red marking on top of it, and gives us a table out. So this is maybe the most common image analysis workflow in ImageStay. We will do it after the lecture next week, actually. I'm just mentioning here that this is the typical way of going through such a workflow. So you start from your image, you have different dialogues where you enter step by step what you want to do, and by the end you get a table out. And as all this clicking takes time, there is a so-called ImageStay macro language which allows you to automate all that. So the steps I just showed you on the slide before are actually a 5-line program which would do exactly the same, and you will learn in the third lecture how to do this yourself. Furthermore, the Fiji main window has a lot of buttons, right? So there's different annotation tools. So you can, for example, draw a rectangle and draw a circle on regions in your image. And what I was told in my second or in my third year in the field, that there is a right click button here. You can click with your right right mouse button. You can click on this window. You can click on these buttons, and there are additional tools. And when you kind of go through this, you will see that, okay, we have circles, but we also have ellipsoids. We have a single point selection tool, and we have a multiple point selection tool. So for example, if you want to by hand count cells, it may make sense to mark them all to later on have kind of a number of them. Furthermore, you can also double click on some of the buttons, and then you can configure these tools a bit more in detail. So I was told that very late during my time in the field, that's why I'm telling you now in the first lecture, that you can actually get some more tools out of these tools by double clicking and right clicking. And the buttons where you can do that, they are marked with this red triangle, by the way. Furthermore, you can, for example, if you want to measure the distance, something, just a rough distance measurement, right? You can draw a line, and while drawing that line, the length of that line will be shown here. As soon as you release your mouse button, this length measurement will be gone. And you should know that looking at the status bar of the Fiji window gives you some additional information sometimes. Furthermore, also important, you can press the M key on your keyboard in order to save a measurement like that into a results table. And it works in many contexts. For example, when you draw a line, you get a length measurement. If you draw a circle, you can, for example, get a mean intensity measurement. And that sometimes really helps a lot to just get some rough measurements, right? Furthermore, the Fiji user interface, again, looks like this. You have your main window, and you have an image window. And this image window contains a lot of information here. So let's quickly go through what this all means. So you see, first of all, the zoom factor, how enlarged the image is on your screen. You see here in brackets behind, and you can use the minus and the plus key to zoom in to different regions. So let me just demonstrate that to you. I'm pressing now the plus key to increase this window, and furthermore, dependent on where I put the mouse button, I can zoom further in. Right? So this is also something I was told very late while learning ImageStay, and that's why I'm telling you now. The position of the mouse button matters when it comes to zooming in. Furthermore, you see here the image type. So this is a 16-bit image. And you can in the menu when you click here on image, you can change that type, and you can change from 16 to 8-bit. Again, this is you have information loss here. And when you change from 8-bit to 16-bit, you do not get this information back. So sometimes you have to switch, especially if you want to subtract one image from another. I would strongly recommend using 32-bit because 32-bit images allow negative values. 8 and 16-bit do not. And you should switch types from time to time, but you should always be aware of what you are doing here. Furthermore, you see here with microns, you see the physical size of the whole image, so in X and Y, so that's width and height. And in behind, you see how many pixels there are in this image, in X and in Y. And furthermore, you see the current channel. C stands for channel, the current C slice position in a stack, right? So that's the third dimension. And you see a time point. So in this particular case, we have 51 time points, and we are now at time point one. And if I wanted to go to the in further in the future, I could now move this bar to the right, and I would see how this data set develops over time. You sometimes have to correct the pixel size when opening a data set. So if your image does not tell you the physical properties, so there's no microns here, only tells pixels, then that means kind of the import of your image into ImageStay hasn't worked correctly, and then you should go to the menu Image Properties and kind of correct that. So here it says the unit, the pixel width is 1 pixel, right? And you can change that actually by entering the correct values. I would say most of the microscopes these days save these images correctly, and ImageStay can also read most of the images correctly, but in some cases it does not. Oh yeah, and that's also a hint. The micron symbol may be hard to find on the one or the other keyboard. That's why you can just enter a U here, and this U will be interpreted as micron. One of the first steps you should always do, or in many cases you should do that when opening an image. So I just opened this MRI image, and you may agree that it's actually hard to differentiate structures. So I can see the outer skin in white pretty nicely, but I do not really see structures inside the brain with some kind of differentiability. And that's why maybe one of the most common shortcuts in ImageJ is Control Shift and C, and you also find this in the menu. Allows you open such a window where you can change the brightness and contrast, where you can change the minimum and the maximum of the shown intensity. So what we are doing here by moving this maximum bar, we are actually stretching the lookup table above or below our histogram. So this is the histogram of our data set. We see there's not so much black, but there's a lot of gray and some white. And we can actually, by moving the minimum and the maximum bar, and also the contrast and the brightness bar, we can kind of change how these gray values are visualized on screen. And if you see a peak in your histogram, like here is all the information in this image is mostly distributed in this region. You can configure your lookup table so to just show this region, and then you have the image with most of the contrast. So when you open an image later in the exercise, move the minimum and the maximum bar a bit, move brightness and contrast, and get a bit of feeling about what you are doing here. What's also important is that this is just for visualization. This just happens on the screen. So the pixel values here will still be the same. So it's like we are not changing anything to this image. We just change how it's visualized on screen. And if you have a multi-channel image like this image I showed you earlier, again, you see here a bar on the very bottom where you can switch between different channels. So we have here a red channel, a green channel, and a blue channel. And if you want to change the minimum and the maximum intensity on these channels, you have to do it for every channel. So if I now I open this image and I change here minimum, maximum brightness, contrast, only the red will change. So if I want to do this for green and for blue, I have to move this bar to the right and then do it for green and blue individually. That is also important if you want to do measurements. For example, I have my mouse pointer here at this particular point in the image, and I can again in the status bar of ImageJ, I can read that this value here at this point in space is 421. And that counts for the red channel. So we see here the red channel is marked. We can see it with red. We also see that the bars on the left. And in this channel, the intensity is 421. If I now move this bar to the right, so for example, or to the center, first of all, I'm now in the green channel. So it visualizes me here in green. And I can read that in the green channel, the intensity at this particular point is 302. And if I move further to the blue channel, we see that the intensity is here 983. And you may agree that this pixel, the pixel here at this position, mostly appears blue and not green and red. And this is how you can read out pixel values from individual pixels, just again, not in a scientific analysis way, but to get some kind of impression of pixel intensities in a quick way by looking at the bar in Fiji and by configuring the right channel. That's here important at that point. Lookup tables, I told you earlier what that means. And if you want to make this image nicely visible, understandable for people with red-green color blindness, you should change the lookup table. And it again works by selecting the right channel here on the bottom and then going to the menu image lookup tables where you find different lookup tables and can switch, for example, from red to magenta. There are many other very interesting, very cool lookup tables. Just give them a try later in the exercise. And lookup tables are free of choice. So I would recommend always taking lookup tables which are somehow related to the measurement you did. So if you imaged, for example, an M. cherry protein, then this is reddish. So you should use a red channel for visualization. That makes a lot of sense. And it's also then easier to understand for people. But in fact, you are free of choice. You can visualize image as you want. But I would just recommend try not to do arts. Okay, regions of interest. That's something I haven't shown earlier. So that's why we will have a bit closer look at this. In image say, you can draw a rectangle using the rectangle tool. You can draw a circle using the circle tool. Sorry for that one. if you want to combine a rectangle and a circle in one image, you can hold down the shift key on your keyboard. So first you draw a circle, then you switch to the rectangle tool. You hold shift and you draw your rectangle, and then you will see that these two regions of interest, these two ROIs, are together at the same time in the same image. For some measurements, that may indeed make sense. Furthermore, you can combine objects. So I was now drawing another rectangle here by holding down the shift key. You can, with the Alt key, actually remove objects from an ROI. So here I was drawing an ellipsoid, and I was removing it from the outline we just had before. And you can, if you click inside the ROI and move your mouse down while holding the mouse button, you can move an ROI around. And you click outside, it's gone. That sometimes also means that you spend some time in outlining something and then it's suddenly gone. So that's why I'm telling you here, there is a menu, edit selection, restore selection, or there's also a shortcut for that, Control Shift E or Command Shift E on the Mac, which gives you the last ROI back, which was there. That might be helpful in case of an emergency. The brush tool, I already told you that there are right-click buttons. The brush tool is also very popular if you just want to outline a region in a very, I would say, handy, in a very user-friendly way. You can enter the size of the brush by double-clicking, and then you can draw differently sized regions. So here, for example, I draw with a very thick outline, and then you can also make a very small, very, very, very thin object size, and then you can actually cut an object into two. That's very, depending on what you want to do, it's very flexible, very, very handy. And again, it took me some time to discover that. That's why I'm showing you here today. Shift and Alt key I already introduced. And if you, for example, want to outline in an EM data set, such an, I'm not sure what it was, a nucleus or something like that. If you want to outline that very flexibly, I also recommend you to use the brush tool together with the Alt and the Shift keys. To add new objects or to extend objects, or how I'm showing it here, to remove a part of an object like that, right? Can also make calls with holding Alt. Image chain supports a range of measurements. For example, you can measure the area, the mean standard deviation of gray values, and so on. And it works like this. So you outline the region you're interested in, you set the measurements in the Analyze Set Measurements menu, and then you press the M key, and you will see that the configured measurements end up in a table. And then you can open the next image, outline the next region, and do another measurement. So this is the not so automated, the manual way of doing this. And you can also do that on different channels. Ah, yeah, right. You have to do that actually on different channels. So if you want to, you see here the red channel is marked. And if you want to measure the intensity in the green channel, you have to actually switch to the green channel by moving this bar and measure the intensity in the green channel. And you have to be careful about that because the results table does not tell you in which channel this measurement was made. So that's why automation makes sense. But what also makes sense is to document how things are analyzed so that this measurement is later on reproducible. The ROI Manager, it's also a tool in ImageJ, helps you to organize selections of different regions. So just assume you want to outline an object in your image, and then you want to do a measurement, and later on your group leader, your boss asks you, okay, from which object was this outline, was this measurement actually taken? So where is the outline? Show me the outline. And the ROI Manager helps you to keep track of outlines, to keep tracks of regions of interest. So for example, here in this case, I outline this embryo and I press the T key on my keyboard, which adds this outline to the ROI Manager. Then I outline the next object and I press the T key and it goes to the ROI Manager, and I do that a third time. And then I can, in the ROI Manager, I can first of all press the measure key, which will make me three measurements in my results table from these three ROIs. And furthermore, I can also visualize with the show all and with the labels checkbox that region number one with this measurement is actually this thing. So for some kind of visualization of how measurements were derived from a data set, this is very helpful, especially if you want to talk to people about what you have actually done for documentation, for reproducibility of your analysis workflow. What's also important with Fitchy is, if you use Fitchy, please cite it. If you use it in a scientific paper, in your master thesis, in your PhD thesis, please cite it, because the Fitchy developers at some point would like to get some money for further continuing development. And I borrowed this slide here from Pavel Tomachak. I think it was something like 4 or maybe 3 years ago that he gave me that slide. And back in the days, in 2012, so that was before my time, the citation count of the paper was something like 2000. Then in 2016, I got the slide, so I refreshed that number. It's now almost 3000, and it's continuing. And we are now almost at 20,000 citations, which is pretty cool. So you see there are a lot of people who use this particular software for their scientific image analysis. And only because many of them are citing it, the software can still be developed. So that's kind of important. Furthermore, you should know, or you should just see that it's not a company behind which is developing that. No, it's the scientific community. It's software developers who are PhD students, postdocs, some of them even master students, developing new plugins. And sometimes they meet at hackathons, and sometimes they meet at learnathons. That's, for example, the institute where I'm working now, the Center for Systems Biology in Dresden. So then they are hanging out for 10 days in a row, making Fitchy better, making new tools for Fitchy, serving the next generation of scientists. I'm just saying that this is not a company which makes money, that's people. People, scientists like you and me, who develop software further. And you can actually talk to these people if you go to the ImageSC forum. So that's the URL where you can drop all your image analysis questions. And I'm telling you, because if you do your if you do the exercise which is related to this lecture, if you do it offline later on a weekend, or right, not together with me in a Zoom chat, you can always drop questions there in the forum, and either I answer you or somebody else will answer you. Or later in your master thesis, you want to process some images and you don't know how to do it, or you're not sure about the method, just drop your question there, drop a little image there, try to explain what you want to do, and people will help you for free in the shortest amount of time. Just to show you an example, so that's on September 3, I'm not sure, I think it's 2 years ago, And somebody says, I have two folders with images, so there's like an image X and an image Y in these two folders, and I would like to compare them in a certain way. I would like to analyze the images in pairs. So how do I do that? I have this little script which does it, but I cannot do it on the whole folder. And within a single day, somebody, Selkai in this case, is answering with a full script saying, here, this is how you do. So, and that's pretty cool. In the context of this lecture, I would not recommend you to put your the whole question from the exercise there, because I'm also reading this, and it's like you won't learn anything from that. But if you struggle a bit, just put your question there. It's really welcome to talk to other experts about image analysis. And also important by the very end, also thank the people who help you. So that's kind of kind. So that's the lectures for today. I showed you the basics of image analysis. Again, think about quantitative, objective, reproducible, repeatable, reliable. Also keep in mind that lookup tables do not change your image. They just change the visualization on screen. I also showed you how to do basic measurements, and the exercises on the slides will actually also be some very basic measurements. And next week, I will show you how to semi-automatically doing this. So the idea is that now you're analyzing something manual, and you will now learn more and more how to do these things automatically. I will show you how segmentation thresholding connected components work. So we will start with algorithms in image analysis, and then you can do the same analysis you do now in the exercise this week. You can do in a more automated way next week, and afterwards we will compare them. So see you next week, everyone.